Okay, this will be part five, which is the final part in our look at supercells and tornadoes. We've covered the basic conceptual model for supercell formation. We've looked at non-mesocyclone tornadoes, mesocyclonic tornadoes, and then specifically the supercell composite parameter. We'll wrap this up with the significant tornado parameter, which just builds on what we've already presented to this point. So significant tornadoes, obviously these are quite the threat to life and property, so anything we can do to properly anticipate these events with relatively low false alarm helps our credibility and it gives people a chance to take proper action in advance. What we've done to help with this is to take, much like with the supercell composite, we want some form of a conceptual model based on reality, but it's simple enough to calculate and apply on a daily basis. So what we try to do is, again, like the SCP, we try to look at ingredients specific to mesocyclonic tornado production. So what is it that varies just from a background supercell? What do we need to add to the supercell recipe to get us an environment favorable for tornadoes, and specifically significant tornadoes with those supercells? So we know that we need deep layer vertical shear, buoyancy, and in this case, we'll consider convective inhibition because it's related to stretching potential. So we need long-lived, right-moving supercells if we want to maximize the odds of significant tornado production. Now, we also want to focus on the buoyancy, convective inhibition, and vertical shear near the ground because we're talking about what is the forcing for stretching in the low levels and the resistance to the stretching. So in this case, we need to have something in the profile that tells us how strong is the pressure perturbation close to the ground, how strong is the resistance to stretching down close to the ground so that we can amplify any storm scale vorticity generation up to tornado proportions. And then of course, we've got to come up with some estimate for how buoyant will the rear flank downdraft parcels be. Are they likely to be really cold and stable, or is it likely to be relatively warm and unstable? Okay, so effective SRH, we discussed that and introduced it in the supercell composite portion of this presentation. Here, looking at these cases, we've got effective SRH increases as this increases, the significant tornadic storms are on the right. It's clearly as effective SRH goes up, the potential for significant tornadoes goes up, at least is associated with larger effective SRHs, whereas the non-tornadic storms here of the left box and whisker plot, same conventions as the previous presentation. So we're just looking at values. As they go up, we tend to get larger probabilities of tornado production. ML CAPE, again, most supercells have large CAPE, but if you compare to some of the linear convective modes, they tend to occur in lower buoyancy environments. So it's just typical of supercells. We need larger buoyancy values, but it's not a strong discriminator, but we still need a strong updraft. And then we've got the effective bulk wind difference. Again, once you get into the stronger vertical shear, there actually is a tendency for even stronger deep layer vertical shear with significant tornado producing storms compared to just their weak and non-tornadic counterparts. So there is a little bit of a signal there that we might want to account for. And then when we go to the LCL height point here, lower is better because it reduces evaporative cooling potential. So the non-tornadic storms tend to have higher LCL heights based on the lowest 100 millibar mean parcel, and the significant tornadic storms are over here. So instead of using this as a favorable factor, this is more of a limiting factor. So as you transition from LCL heights, once you go above about 1,000 meters up to in the vicinity of 2,000 meters, significant tornado potential drops dramatically as the LCL heights get higher and higher. And again, that's just it just suggests that we're looking at this probabilistically. It doesn't get into all the details of hydrometeor distribution and the rear flank downdraft. There's a bunch of stuff that you can perhaps say something about with dual pole radar data, but we can't necessarily quantify exactly how that translates into a downdraft and how cold or stable it will be at this point. Okay, and then we have convective inhibition. This is just sort of the background thing. How resistant is the background environment to the stretching potential in the low levels? How easy is it to maintain a storm? Point here is that there's a wider range in the higher values for the non-tornadic storms, whereas most of the significant tornado-producing storms tend to have relatively weaker convective inhibition. So as inhibition increases, there should be a decreasing risk of significant tornadoes because we're talking about amplifying the vorticity near the ground, and if the background environment's resistant to that, then it just makes tornado genesis less probable. Okay, so we come up with the effective layer significant tornado parameter built in much the same way as SCP. We normalize to a little bit bigger value of CAPE because that's just what the statistical distribution looks like. SIGTOR producing supercells tend to have larger buoyancy on average. Effective bulk wind difference, we actually use the same value from the SCP. We're just looking for supercells. Effective SRH, you notice we've tripled the value compared to SCP. This is where the low-level shear matters. We want that vertical shear concentrated in the low levels so that our pressure perturbation and the stretching related to that in the low is closer to the ground. And then we look at the LCL height. This one has to be formulated a little bit differently because lower is better, higher is worse. So in this case, if you plug a 2,000 meter LCL height in there, the entire term goes to zero. And then we throw the convective inhibition again. Once the inhibition goes above about 200, it zeroes this out. So if you don't meet any of these conditions, the whole STP collapses to zero if any of them are violated. Okay, so what happens when we plot this again for proximity soundings with storms? A lot of these other ones that produce just wind and hail, these are right-moving supercells. Notice the significant tornado parameter values are pretty low. They're generally clustered at or below one. When we look at all of the tornadic storms by EF scale, and especially when you get in the twos, the threes, and then the violent tornadoes, there's a pretty dramatic increase. So over here, generally the significant tornadoes are with values greater than one. But again, there's a lot of overlap. These sample sizes are much bigger for the lower end tornadic storms than these. So you know, remember, 10% of this is not plotted. That 10% might actually be the entire size of the violent tornado sample itself. So the probabilities always favor weaker tornadoes or non-tornadic. But the point is we need to sniff out the serious tornadoes because they do by far the most damage. Okay, so the rationale behind this is we want sustained right-moving supercells, and we've got ingredients to reflect that. We want the potential for strong low-level stretching. That's where the effective SRH and, to some extent, convective inhibition come in. And then we've got to say something about the rear flank downdraft and how potentially buoyant is it. And that's a function of how much inflow buoyancy is there, how much CAPE do you start with, how much inhibition do you start with, and then how much evaporational potential, at least loosely represented by the LCL height. And when you have all of these conditions met, strong tornadoes are more probable. That does not mean they will absolutely happen with every single storm, but they become much more probable. Now, there are weaknesses. Again, just like SCP, this is a conditional look at the problem. You have to have a supercell before any of this matters. A SIGTOR parameter of 10 in the absence of deep convection, you're not going to have very many significant tornadoes in the absence of actual storms. And as I've mentioned multiple times, this is a pretty simplified estimate of the storm scale processes. To try to estimate like downdraft potential in the RFD with a single value of the LCL height, you know, anyone does any research after this or continues or looks at numerical simulations or high resolution observations, this is a very complicated problem. It's remarkable that it works as well as it does. We do it because we can actually calculate it. It just requires low-level temperature and moisture observations. And again, this RFD character is tremendously different than just the LCL height. There have been other calculations. I know that Paul Markowski's worked on it where try to explain the variance in the thermodynamic structure of the rear flank downdraft, like how cold is it at the ground using just the LCL height, and maybe two-thirds of the variance was explained by that using vortex observations. That means a third of it was explained by something else, and it could be things like what we call microphysics or hydrometeor distributions. There's all kinds of things that can cause problems. And there's plenty of room to do work in this regard. So it's just the important thing is that you need to consider that there are uncertainties, and that's why we look at this probabilistically. There's no just yes, no answer with it. And again, until you have consistent observations, you're not going to know. So again, the key points here, you've just got to consider that we need the buoyancy, the vertical shear, and something to give us strong low-level stretching and at least a storm scale source for vorticity. And as of right now, this is about the best we've been able to do statistically, but it works pretty well. I can say from operational experience, using this sort of set of ingredients can give you a fairly high probability of detection and you can keep the false alarm in check. So you can do a credible job forecasting significant tornadoes with supercells if you follow this recipe. And again, I'll leave it to you to go over all of this. They're just, you got to consider the limiting factors. And in the end, if you apply this properly, you should be doing a credible job dealing with what ends up being one of the most important forecast problems you will face in the National Weather Service.